Hi, I'm Mike Moore. Welcome to Late Night Frontline Live.
The show's out of my control already. I thought I was going to say that. Bloody Rob Sitch. Now, sit quietly, Rob, while I introduce you. Rob Sitch from Working Dog, whom I've admired for years, for decades, God help us, for generations. Rob, lovely to have you on the program.
Thanks, Philip. Well, you're partly to blame, so we might get to that too.
No, we'll start with that. What do you mean it's my fault?
When you go back through the DNA of the stuff we've done, one of the biggest sort of turning points in our life was doing the Late Show. In the early days of that, let's say it was on shaky feet, and a broadcast by the name of Philip Adams popped up in our soup saying that he really liked the show, in sharp contrast to everybody else in Australia.
I can't believe that wasn't. I remember it as being a smash hit. But of course, I first became very conscious of you guys with D-Gen. I was addicted to D-Gen. I found it so fresh and alive, and well, it was very alive, wasn't it?
It was back in the days when, you know, at the ABC that had a comedy department, and you sort of took over a studio for a 6-month period and a big production team, and we sort of followed after Australia standing in it. And in some ways, for
Rod
us,
Quantock least, there.
Yeah. In terms of getting the ABC back into the comedy making mode, they did quite a bit of ice breaking for us, I reckon. I think comedy's very fragile early. You need a lot of flying hours, and you don't have enough when you get the opportunity. And, you know, so you need a bit of luck and you need to run into the right people. But the ABC, in a way, lets you, I think, sort of tolerates you in that early period.
And, of course, the Late Show down the track was live to air, wasn't it?
Insane. I mean, you look back at
that. Nothing. We should point out that nothing's live now.
Nothing.
John Stewart's not live.
No.
Colbert's not live.
No.
They're pre-recorded and they're subject to quite subtle editing.
Yeah, well, it's now it's a sort of mark of quality is that at the end of the Daily Show, they, you know, if you want to watch the full interview, you go online. But I don't know why. It was a slightly mad thing to do in retrospect. And I was only saying this to someone who's sort of starting out in comedy today. Now they've got, you know, if we did the Late Show now, you would have tweets and social media, and you'd have a sense that you were striking a chord. But we sort of spent a whole year feeling like we hadn't struck a chord. And then sort of towards the end of the first year, we just found out that all the teenagers were watching it. And that was a big turning point for us.
Let me ask for a quick bio, because this is something, a question I often ask guests. I'm talking about, how did you become who you are? Now, I understand that you are, in fact, a qualified doctor.
Back then, you know, before Hex and all of those sorts of things, it was like you sort of entered a wonderland of choice. And I thought I'd try medicine because I'd always had a bit of a sneaking love of science. And so then midway through medicine, I walked into an audition and got in. And I'd never done a play before. I'd never been cast before. And I must have been about 20 and absolutely loved it. And so that kind of stalled my medical degree. I finished it and did my internship. But I was juggling, you know, TV during the middle of doing a medical degree. And then after my internship, I went to the medical director and I said, I'm thinking of going back to comedy. And he didn't try and stop me. So I took that as a sign.
If there's one ingredient that links everything you've done, it is a fascination with how things work, don't work, and should work. That was certainly, well, Frontlines is about how a news program allegedly works,
yes.
Didn't work. The Castle was a very fond image of how the legal system might work if we lived in a kinder world.
Yeah.
The Newey, which I think is wonderful utopia, I have a feeling it's been planned on graph paper, you know, the same way that John Cleese and his then Mrs.
Yes.
worked on Fawlty Towers. It's so immaculately put together. But it's about, well, the grandiose schemes of government and what and how fraudulent many of them are and how things disintegrate. But there's another link in everything you do, and that is that it's kind. You've never been a cruel comedian.
I'll take that as a welcome compliment, because one of the things that I often say to people is that a lot of comedy is an attack, and that's fine, but at some point you've got to do something about something you love. And I noticed that all the impersonations that I used to do, I actually really only impersonated people I quite had a soft spot for. And it was almost talking like them was because it was almost like singing a song that I liked, a tune that I liked. And that's interesting. I almost think it's, for some comedians, it's harder to admit you like something than it is to go on the attack.
Well, the Chaser Boys are lovely blokes, as you know.
Yes,
you
know, I know.
Julian and the rest of them. But occasionally I've had crosswords with Julian because I found the Chaser has been venomously cruel from time to time. I love the gentleness of spirit that pervades even Utopia. Utopia is full of the most obnoxious people, but you view them with some sort of tenderness.
Well, I find that when you craft something, the more you craft something, the crueler edges drop away. I think that that's been, the more drafts you do, the more human you make it. I also think that, well, the comedians I like are curious people. And I think, you know, it's very hard to maintain a rage when you're curious about human beings.
Will teams like yours form in the post-mass media era? Will it be possible for these creative coalitions to be created? I suppose Will Ferrell's doing it with that, you know, that website thing of his.
Yeah, I reckon there's two types. I reckon there's a Barry Humphries who only needs his own brain in a way. And then there's people like us. And I reckon there's always young groups coming through that in a way comedy is an iterative process. It's like you're tinkering with something in a shed. And we often, when we do a draft, we always try and keep some of us out of that process. And I call them dental appointments. You know, it's going along to find out what's wrong. And a lot of comedy works like that. You've got to go back and forth between people. We still meet every day. And I've realised that at least, you know, 10, 15 minutes of every day, someone walking into someone else's, you know, little office and going, gee, I just heard this or I just noticed that. And we've never stopped working that way. Maybe someone like John Clark's halfway in between. He could do it all by himself, but he enjoys people, so he does it. Sometimes, you know, he collaborates. But technology innovation hit just when we needed it. And we were able to buy editing equipment and pretty high-end video equipment for a fraction of the cost that it was, you know, even 10 years before. And so young comedians coming up now will edit, shoot, write, you know, and post their stuff on YouTube, and that tends to come in a team.
I was talking before about some of your impersonations. They're incredibly good, and they haven't aged a bit, but some of them you wouldn't get away with. I don't think you'd get away with Desmond Tutu, for example, or with Yasser Arafat.
No. It's funny is that time and distance helps the comic. And back then, before the 24-hour news cycle and broadband connection, even if you did offend someone, it you know, someone had to mail a tape across the world for them to feel defamed. Whereas I think now it's, you know, offence is rapidly taken today and rapidly circulated.
Morning, Tony.
Morning, Amy.
Chai?
Listen, I need coffee and real tea back in that kitchen, and I need some decent biscuits, and I don't want them made with spelt.
Are you feeling stressed?
Yes, Amy.
Good news. Your body's detoxing. Soon you'll start feeling even more irritable and start thinking irrationally. Best not to make any major decisions.
Why did you take on something as subtle as Utopia? It's not in your face.
That's an interesting observation you make, because when we started it, we weren't dealing with the grand scale it ended up. We just kept amusing each other with modern absurdities. You know, someone told us about an office that had gluten-free muffins, and then they found out the person that they were getting them for had left on a gap year 3 months before, and then they had a meeting to decide whether the gluten would go back into muffins. And then we realised that absurdity, in a way, is a sign of the modern complexity of life, and that it doesn't matter how big you make it, you know, you can make it the national broadband network, is that kind of the stupidity or absurdity scales up no matter where you go. And so my observation, or my belief is that I reckon that marketing terms have become so potent that if you've got a good slogan, it's better than having a good project.
It is an entirely inappropriate building for that site.
You see buildings like that everywhere. How do they get up?
Well, I'll tell you what they do, and this infuriates me. They design them in some sort of meaningless shape or curve, and they call them iconic or a landmark building. But that's just a big excuse to put up a big, great... What do you wonder, what are you doing?
Exactly what you're suggesting.
I didn't suggest anything.
We need to make this a landmark.
No.
An iconic structure.
Rhonda.
This is wonderful.
It's not wonderful, Rhonda. Just listen to me.
You've just changed the conversation. Love
Rhonda.
It. Good work, everyone.
Rhonda.
I drove down to Canberra at the weekend, and we're halfway down, and suddenly there's a dirty, great big sign saying Nation Building. We almost drove off the road. What a publicity stunt. How the hell did you organise that?
Well, it's a struggle because just about everything with Australia in it has been copyrighted. So there was Infrastructure Australia and Nation Building Australia. But in actual fact, when we hit upon Nation Building Authority, it's got quite a good ring to it. And then there was as we were filming, an election was being fought. And I think that they started to fight on our battleground, which was, infrastructure. I think Tony Abbott said he wanted to be the infrastructure prime minister. So that was a bit of a tailwind for us.
And at the same time, you've got to be scrupulously apolitical. That's a dazzlingly difficult tightrope to walk on.
Well, fortunately, Philip, stupidity is bipartisan. So grand dreams, it's a very human thing. I tripped over something 2 or 3 years ago that Athens almost went broke building the Parthenon. And it just amuses me that nation building Athens in, 500 BC was sending them broke then.
Well, the pyramids had the same problem, as you know. They were immensely expensive, these bloody great big silly paperweights in the desert, and they didn't even work. They were meant to preserve the tomb of a great pharaoh. No one ever found the body of Cheops. It failed in its purpose. The biggest building on earth for thousands of years.
I've got a bit of a soft spot for the nation building projects, and that I'm sure you've been, you've interviewed David Walsh down at Mona. I mean, it's sort of 50% folly and 50% just amazing. And if you try to justify it on paper, you can't quite. And so in some of these things, maybe they live beyond economics.
It's been an absolute tonic. I've enjoyed it enormously. Thank you for giving a bit of your time from your preposterously busy life.
Good on you, Philip. Thank you.